Between the end of the Civil War and the turn of the 20th century, the U.S. became a more industrialized and urbanized nation. These changes brought many benefits to society, but created problems as well. In this video, we will review how Americans responded to these changes at home in the years 1890 to 1920. Welcome to History Crash Course, the Progressive Era.
How did progressives work to reform American society to improve living and working conditions in cities, correct both state and local government corruption, and advance the rights of minorities?
Progressive reformers had a variety of motivations, used different methods, and had different degrees of success in achieving reforms. Progressives supported the use of government power as it posed to charities, churches, civic groups, or individuals to bring about reform. Progressive politicians promoted labor laws, consumer protections, environmental regulations, and democratic reforms.
Americans faced social, political, and environmental problems at the turn of the century. Many of these problems were the result of rapid changes brought on by industrialization, urbanization, and immigration. The rise of industry had stimulated rapid urbanization, which is the growth of cities, by creating jobs that drew rural residents and new immigrants to American cities.
Advances in technology, transportation, and communications helped fuel rapid industrial growth after the Civil War. The textile industry, for example, was one of the first to mechanize. The iron and steel industry also thrived in the late 1800s. As factory production increased, businesses looked for ways to keep costs low and profits high in order to beat out others in the competitive market. And one of the best ways to do it at the time was to keep wages low, hours long, and working conditions awfully poor.
The Progressive Era was a difficult time to be a worker. While progressives did try to make working conditions better for laborers due to muckraking and labor unions, their efforts yielded low results. Laborers were behind the railroads that stretched across over 3,000 miles of the continent. The steel rails that provided the tracks, the skyscrapers that dominated city skylines, the textiles that clothed the Western world, and the coal and oil that fueled the transportation revolution. They typically worked 7 days a week, 12 hours each day, some enduring 24 hours of intense labor, every other Sunday, what was known as the long turn. This was hard manual labor that seldom gave employees any pause or rest during their shift. There was no nationally mandated minimum wage until 1938. Railroad workers in the 1880s could expect to make about 10 cents an hour, and if the economy turned sour, the company would cut all wages down to 9 cents.
Even children faced the hazards of labor. If the workers had daughters, they began working in childcare or other odd jobs before the age of 15 to help the family survive. Boys as young as 12 got jobs crawling in newly blasted areas in coal mines to scoop out loose chunks of coal. Of the 20 million industrial workers nationwide in 1900, 1.7 million were children. This was twice as many child laborers as there had been in 1870. Between 1880 and 1900, 500,000 to 1 million laborers were injured every year, while some 35,000 workers perished each year in factory and mining incidents, the highest rate in the industrial world.
Magazines became a more popular medium in the 1900s. The heavy coverage of corruption in politics, local government, and big businesses helped attribute to the rapid expansion of national advertising and lower cover prices. Muckrakers, or journalists who wrote for popular magazines to expose social and political sins and shortcomings, worked to expose social ills and corporate political corruption. The Jungle by Upton Sinclair was not only a muckraking novel, but also a prominent example of a socialist novel. It portrayed the harsh conditions and exploited lives of immigrants in industrialized cities in the United States. In the American meatpacking industry during the early 20th century, greatly contributed to reforms like the Meat Inspection Act. Sinclair famously said, quote, "I aimed at the public's heart, and by accident, I hit it in the stomach."
Between 1900 and 1915, More than 50 million immigrants arrived in the United States, nearly equal to the amount of immigrants who had arrived in the previous 40 years combined. The Progressive Era was a period of time in the United States from the 1890s to the 1920s. This era is associated with the Progressive Reform Movement, which called for more workers and job opportunities. Increasing the concentration of industrialized cities, this rise in industrialization and urbanization attracted immigrants from Southern and Eastern European countries, reflecting the steady influx of immigrants into the United States today.
The Progressive Movement did very little to help minorities. The progressives were interested in promoting the interests of middle-class America, but their vision of middle-class America was largely centered on whites. African-Americans and immigrants often faced discrimination socially and politically through the establishment of government policies such as Jim Crow laws and literacy tests, which effectively restricted voters in the minority group. Women, on a similar note, did not receive the right to vote until the passage of the 19th Amendment in 1919.
Hello, welcome to the voting booth. You have to take this literacy test to see if you're eligible to vote. You have to get 80 out of 100 to pass. Good luck.
Ang hirap naman ito. Parang hindi nila gusto kang pumasa.
In this edition of Crash Course Biography, we'll be talking about a man who briefly joined the socialists and emerged from this period as one of the most forceful and eloquent speakers for blacks since Frederick Douglass. His name was W.E.B. Du Bois. Born in Massachusetts, he was the first black to receive a PhD from Harvard in 1895. He taught, lectured, and wrote, his most notable work being the classic The Souls of Black Love in 1903. Rejecting Washington's conservative restraint, Du Bois joined in founding the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, also known as the NAACP, in 1909. At that time, a white-dominated organization, and became editor of his journal, The Crisis, where he served for a quarter century. Du Bois left the NAACP in 1934, where he promoted a more radical strategy and returned to teaching. 10 years later, he rejoined the NAACP, and in 1945, was one of the Americans in attendance at the founding of the United Nations. Du Bois later joined the Communist Party, left America, and renounced his citizenship, moving to Ghana, where he sadly died.
Progressives also wanted to protect the natural environment. They saw how industry and urban growth had polluted the air and water, as well as devastated the landscape. Progressives like John Muir and President Roosevelt were known to be preservationists, while other progressives were conservationists.
I support conservation, limited use of resources. I believe that government should take a middle position between exploitation and preservation. Take this wooden bench, for example. We should preserve the wilderness while also allowing some use of its natural resources.
I support preservation, the protection of lands from all forms of development. Who would want to get rid of all of these beautiful flowers? The government tended to favor the more moderate conservationist approach. In 1905, President Roosevelt backed the creation of the U.S. Forest Service to protect forests and other natural areas from excessive development. The federal government set aside near 150 million acres of national forests. President Taft added 2.7 million acres to the National Wildlife Refuge System. In 1916, Wilson supported the creation of the National Park Service Congress, which was created to manage all the parks for preservation and public use. Through this mandate, preservationists accepted the idea that tourism and economic development could help protect the natural landscape.
This map shows the effects of the preservative views of many progressive leaders in maintaining the environment. As you can see on the map, only 5 national parks existed by the starting years of the progressive era in 1900. However, under the influence of progressive leaders during this time period, 12 additional parks were able to be created. 5 under President Roosevelt, 1 under President Taft, and an additional 6 under President Wilson.
The Progressive Era was a period of great reform movements, including 1. Political reforms at the city, state, and federal levels, 2. Social welfare reforms, 3. Economic reforms, and 4. Scientific rational administration practices to cut down tradition, waste, and corruption in business and government. Reforms affected some groups differently and had varying degrees of success.